praise God. Praise his name with all we have. Good morning, church. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. just say that?
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who. That is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Thank you, Lord, for being a awesome Father. We praise your name. We praise your name. In Jesus' name, we say amen. You may be seated.
All right, happy Sabbath, church. Let me try that again. Happy Sabbath, church. All right, that's a little bit more like it. We are so glad that you are here this Sabbath. Once again, you guys all look great, just as you do every Sabbath. So why don't you turn to the person next to you and just tell them, hey, you look great. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you, Father, for such an amazing Sabbath, Father, where we can come together and sing and declare, Father, that you are that way maker, that promise keeper. You're that light in the darkness. Father, we ask that as your Spirit was with us in Sabbath school, that it continues to be with us in this service. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, so this morning I want to talk to you a little bit about what we are sort of covering for the month. And does anybody remember the title for this month again? Core, right? In other words, we're trying to get to the nucleus, to the center of our faith and our walk with God. Oops, I think I showed you before. That was my fault. But today I want to talk to you about this law. Now, many of us, most of us here, are what we call Seventh-day Adventist Christians, right? And we're weird, right? Would you agree? A little bit? No? I think so, all right? We have a little few things, but we're great. We're awesome. And sometimes what we tend to do is put a little bit of an emphasis on what we call the Ten Commandments, right? I think during Sabbath school was discussed a little bit. Santi had some good points. Arlie did such a great job with it. But I want to point to you and just kind of maybe just ask you, right? We are very familiar with the Ten Commandments, but does anybody know what happens right after the Ten Commandments? Anybody? Without looking at your Bibles. Without looking at your Bibles. Does anybody know what happens right after the Ten Commandments?
People got scared.
But what happens after? There's some instructions after that. And does anybody know what they say? No. But no, that's not what it says. But by the way, don't feel bad. Don't feel bad, because there is a point where God does speak and they say, hey, look, whatever he says, we'll do, right? But they do get scared, right? Now, does anybody know or remember how the Ten Commandments go? Let's go to Exodus chapter 20. All right, Exodus chapter 20. And does anybody remember the first commandment? You shall not have what? Other gods before me. What's number two? We don't have to say them verbatim, but what's this number two? You shall not make any graven images or bow down before them. What's the third one? You shall not take the name of the Lord name in vain, right? What about number four? That's a little louder, right? Yeah, I see a little bit more enthusiasm on that, right? Remember the Sabbath day to keep it what? Holy, right? All right, what about commandment number five? Honor your father and thy mother. Number six, You shall not murder, and you shall not kill. Number seven, adultery. All right, you shall not commit adultery. Number eight, you shall not steal. Number nine, you shall not bear false witness. Number 10, you shall not covet. All right, now we are, you guys did a pretty good job, all right, with the Ten Commandments, but there is something that happens right after the Ten Commandments, and you would think that what happens after the Ten Commandments is very important, right? And I think Rick was the one that brought it up. He said they were scared, and yes, there was a reaction to this, but in the context of giving these Ten Commandments, there's a reaction, right? And the reaction is that they are scared. Now, before I go in and we jump into the text, I want to read to you a quote. It says, the law of God's kingdom is a transcript of his what? Character. Now, that's an important issue to bring up, since we're talking about core and we're getting into the core of our faith, is to recognize that the law of God is actually a transcript of what? Of his character. Now, it's very, very important for us to recognize that very point, because we have been taught, at least I have been taught, I can't speak for you, but I have been taught, and maybe you have been too, where these are set of rules, correct? And if we don't do them in a certain kind of way, in this manner, then we're not really Christians. Has anybody else been taught that, right? And if you do not do it, well, shame on you, right? Nobody wants to admit it. Can you believe this, Carmen? It's all good. But anyway, I'll admit, right? That's how we've been taught. But if we take this point of saying, hey, the law of God is actually a transcript of his what again? Of his character, then it gives us a better understanding, and it comes up right after the Ten Commandments. Now, let's go to Exodus chapter 20, and we're going to begin in verse 20, and we're going to go all the way to verse 26. This is going to be the main course right here, okay? So whatever you do, you put your little, you know, you can put a pencil there, you can put your finger there. We're going to come back and forth into this text. And it says there in Exodus chapter 20, verse 20, in the context of giving these Ten Commandments, look at what it says. So Moses said to the people, do not be what? Afraid, for God has come to test you so that his fear may be in you that you do not sin. What? Was it just me who had this reaction when I read this? I'm like, what? So you're telling me, right, Moses, that don't be afraid. God has only come to make you afraid, right? That's how I read it, right? Now, when we look at this text, again, remember, because we are looking, and if this is a transcript of his character, in other words, the law is actually the transcript of a person, of a what? A person in which he's inviting you into that relationship that has a few stipulations, correct? Now, we all operate under these stipulations. How so? Well, the first commandment, I'm just going to do it really quick. The first commandment is you shall not have any other what? Any other gods. So in a relationship context, imagine me telling my wife, right? I'll marry you, but there will be other women. Would that fly? Ladies, would that fly? Absolutely not, right? And so God here is saying, hey, I am going to be your only God in this relationship. Number two, right? He says, you shall not make any other gods, or you shall not carve and bow, right? What do you use to carve? What do you use to carve something with? Your hands, right? And what do you use, what part of the body do you use to bow? Your body, your torso, right? You use your entire body. So imagine me telling my wife, look, I'll marry you, right? Okay, you'll be the only one, but you won't have my body. Is that going to work? Probably not, right? Probably not, right? So here's God, and he's saying, not only do I want you, I want your body. Does that make sense? Number three, God says, what did he say in those Ten Commandments? He says, you shall not take the name of the Lord God in vain, and you will not hold him guiltless until he takes his name in vain. In other words, what do we use to proclaim the word of God or proclaim God? What part do we use? our mouths, right? To take the name of the Lord God name in vain. Now keep this in mind. It's like me telling my wife, look, you'll be the only one. You'll have my body, but don't expect to have any meaningful conversation. Would that fly?
Yes.
No, right? It will not fly, right? It won't. It wouldn't work, right? How would we then express? Would that relationship work, Claudia? I mean, words for you now are extremely important, right? Imagine your husband telling you that, look, I'll marry you, you'll have my body, but don't expect me to call you or have any conversation with you. What would you do? We'll save it for later. We'll talk later. All right, but imagine that. All right, and then the last one, remember the Sabbath day and what? And keep it holy. Oh, right? It looks different, doesn't it? All right, so here's God, right? Imagine me telling my wife, you'll be the only one. You'll have, you know, we'll have a conversation from time to time. You'll have my body, right? But don't expect any quality time. Right? Don't expect any date. Nothing. Right? Would that fly? Probably not. So here is God, and he's setting this up, and he's letting them know. Now, remember, the people of Israel are coming from where? Where are they coming from in this context of this story of Exodus chapter 20? And we see it there in Exodus chapter 20, verse 1. He says, I am the Lord your God who has called you out of where? Where are they coming from? Egypt. Right? Now, in Egypt, did they have one god or many gods?
Many
gods. Right? So they are coming from a context of watching paganism in full display. Right? They watch it at a day-to-day basis. And now here they are at the foot of the mountain. Here is Moses. Here they are. And God declares to them what we call the Ten Commandments. Right? He declares to them a transcript of his character. And when they hear that, they say what? Let's look at it, right? And Moses is there. Hey, don't be afraid of God. God has just come down to make you afraid. But this afraid part is actually very important. It's saying, hey, don't be afraid of God. He has come down to you so you can be afraid of sin. Does that make sense? Right? So that you do not sin. He is bringing to them a fear. Now, here's the important, here's one thing to recognize. There are many who claim that say, hey, wait, you can't make people afraid into the faith. Well, is being scared part of the human experience? Yes or no? Right? And what is the purpose of fear in general? Well, first of all, it's sort of a coping and a protection mechanism that we use, right? If I see my child, right, in a big boulevard, let's say I'm on 441, because that's where I live, by where I live, right? I'm on 441, and I see Caleb making a beeline without looking anywhere, just straight running. Am I going to say, hey, you know what? Maybe you should think about what you're doing. I'm not going to get into that, right? I'm just going to try to grab him and save him because what? He's in danger. And then I'm going to have a conversation with him and say, hey, you need to be careful because if you cross the street without looking, what's going to happen? Something really bad is going to happen, right? So fear, God uses at least fear in a proper context for us in order for us to understand it's not being afraid of God, but it's being afraid of sin, right? Because sin, we know that the wages of sin is what? Death. And I think that's a pretty legit question. How many of us are afraid of death? I am. I don't want to die, right? I don't want to die. I want to live, right? And so here Moses is setting this context. He's letting them know. And just to make sure, he goes on and he continues saying the following. And look at what it says. The people stood afar while Moses drew near to the thick of the darkness where God was, right? So they were scared. They would say, oh, no, you know what? You talk to him. Because that God is real, right? We are used to seeing carven images in Egypt and all of this. You speak to him because if he continues, we're going to die. And so Moses went up. Then God said to Moses, say to Israel, you yourselves have seen that I have spoken to you from where? From heaven. In other words, he's here and he's like, hey, you have just heard me. You have just seen that I have spoken to you from heaven. Do not make any gods of gold and silver alongside me, and do not make gods of gold for yourselves. So here it is. He sort of reviews this idea again and saying, hey, the reason why God says this is because as they were in the foot of the mountain, God is covered in what? In clouds. Dark clouds are covering them. And he's putting this particular text here, or this particular phrase, to make sure, to let them understand that they didn't see a figure, they didn't see an image, because the tendency is, if you were to see God, right, there was no selfie back then, right? There was, hey, look, it's God, let's take a selfie, right? There wasn't any of that, right? So in order for them to memorize that image, and they would start making images to that, and just say, hey, make sure to let them know that they didn't see anything when I was speaking to them from heaven, right? And so he continues on, and it says, you are to make an altar of the earth. Now, this is interesting, right? And this is where I was pointing to when I was asking this whole idea, what comes after the Ten Commandments? There's an instruction here, and he tells them to build an altar, but an altar made of what? In my Bible there, it says earth, right? Earth and stone. We're going to see that in just a minute. For me. And there you will sacrifice your burnt offerings, your fellowship offerings, your sheep, your cattle. In every place where I cause my name to be mentioned, I will come to you and bless you. It continues saying, when you make for me an altar of stones, do not build it from cut stone. For if you use a tool on it, you will profane it. And he finishes off this part by saying, nor are you to go up to the altar on steps that your nakedness would be uncovered while on it. Now, there's some things here, right? It may seem a little strange, and it is, right? God tells them, all right, they hear the Ten Commandments, right? This entering into that relationship, and the Bible calls it covenant, right? That relationship covenant, which, by the way, we all enter into covenants all the time, right? We enter into business covenants. We enter into marriage covenants. We enter into friendship covenants. We enter into project covenants. You enter into a church covenant in the sense that, you know, when you commit to something in a covenant, you're committing to the stipulations. There's an expectation of this, right? Like marriage, right? There's an expectation, Carmen, that Rick is going to follow through, right? And if he breaks any of those, there's going to be some serious problems. Yeah, she did this. I don't know what that means. I hope that means go away, not slapping him. Right? So you know, the idea here, again, is Jesus telling them and understanding to make sure, again, to this idea that the commandment keeping is not really going to save them, but it's going to be something else. And he commands them to make this altar of stone and of earth. But the stone has a specific indication. It has to be what kind of stone? Not cut, right? No stone, no natural stone, because if they put a tool on it, what happens? It doesn't work anymore. I'm not going to accept that. That's what God says. And also, there's another one. There any what? No, nor are you to make any steps towards those altars. Okay, now this is interesting. Now, if you're like me, you just start asking questions, right? The first question is, what is the purpose of an altar? Why an altar? Instead of me giving you the answer, let's go to Scripture. So open up your Bibles in Genesis chapter 8, verse 20 to 21. And here we find the first instance of this idea of the altar. We've seen sacrifice before with Cain and Abel, but this is the first instance that we see the actual word altar in Scripture. In Genesis chapter 8, verses 20 to 21, so open up your Bibles. And it says, Noah built an altar to the Lord, and took of every clean animal and clean bird and offered a what? Burnt offering on the altar. Now, look at what that first sentence says in verse 21. It says, and the Lord smelled a what? A soothing aroma or a sweet savior, right? Depending on what version you're reading. So here's the altar, and now I want you to sort of get the idea here of a smooth aroma, soothe aroma, or a sweet savor, and pin it on your memory there. We're going to come back to that. Okay, but here, Noah sets this altar. He puts a very clean animal. With what purpose? What just happened in the story of Noah? The flood, right? And so they're there. They finish. God has delivered them. They've gone through this really crazy experience, right? And so Noah builds the altar, and he does it for worship, correct? God has delivered them. God has been awesome, and God is there. So God is there. So one part of this idea of the altar is for worship. Do we understand? All right, that's one. Number two is Genesis chapter 22. Let's look at Genesis chapter 22, and we're going to see there another purpose for the altar. And let's read from verse 13, and it says, "And Abraham lifted his eyes and looked behind him, a ram caught in a thicket by horns." So this is, just to give you context, this is Abraham. He's about to sacrifice who? Isaac, his son, right? And as he is there, right, he's about, and the angel stops him and says, "Abraham, Abraham, don't kill the lad," right? And so then the Lord provides something, and he looks, and he sees a ram caught in a thorn in a thicket. And so Abraham went and took the ram, offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. And verse 14 says, "And Abraham called the name of the place, 'The Lord will provide,' as it is said, 'To this day, in the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided.'" So here's the other occasion, and Abraham is a memorial. So there's two occasions here by which we see the use of altars, and it's two things, or mainly two things. But number one is worship, and number two, it's a memorial. Is that correct? Of what God, how awesome God is, and what he has done, and how God provides for us in every single step. Now, I want you to think about this idea here. We today, if I were to put here an altar, first of all, you would think I'm crazy. And second of all, it's a building hazard, right? If I were to just put an altar here of rocks or of dirt, and then put a sacrifice in it, say, "Hey, all right, guys, let's praise the Lord for this, and this is going to be a memorial for opening English service," right? Now we don't use that in today's context, right? But we know that here is the Lord, and these two ideas of worship and memorial is for us a lesson, and we're going to see this lesson. But I want us to see this idea here of what goes on in the altar. So the idea here, it's not the altar, but it's what the altar is going to do. And what is the altar going to do? Well, first of all, it's going to burn something. What is it going to burn? What is it going to burn? The sacrifice. What type of sacrifice? Because remember, in Cain and Abel, they both brought it to the altar, but one was rejected and one was accepted, right? But which one was the one that was accepted? It's not that complicated. It's called a lamb, right? A lamb, a clean animal, right? And what did the lamb represent? Oh, now we're getting somewhere, right? The lamb represented who? Jesus, right? The lamb was, it was all about that, the emphasis and the thing that needed to be focused on was not the altar itself, but what was on the altar, and what was it going to do? It was going to burn. It was going to burn the sacrifice, and it was going to be a what? A lamb. That's why when we read John, and John the Baptist sees Jesus, he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God that what? Takes away," oh, come on, church, "the sin of the what? Of the world," right? And so here is John, and he's looking at that. Now, when he saw Jesus, it's not as though Jesus was on four legs acting like a lamb going, meh. What he was making an application, right? So the power of the altar was not in the lamb itself. It was in the application of the altar. Does that make sense? Now, as they are here, let's when this sacrifice, when this altar, when Jesus is put on the altar, right? It's an indication that right, that again, the emphasis is on the sacrifice, which is Jesus. Right now, allow me to bore you with a few more texts, okay? Let's look at Leviticus. Those don't sound too exciting, right? Like Matthew or Mark. But let's go to Leviticus chapter 1. Leviticus chapter 1, and we're going to do verse 2. Actually, verse 1. And we're going to read this, and look at what it says about the burnt offering. I want us to hone in on this idea of a smooth, soothing aroma or a sweet savior. And look at what it says. Now the Lord called Moses and spoke to him from the tabernacle meeting, saying, "Speak to the children of Israel and say to them, when one of you brings an offering to the Lord, you shall bring your offering of a livestock, of the herd, and of the flock." Let's jump down to verse 8. And it says, "Then the priest, Aaron's son, shall lay the parts and the head and the fat in the order of the wood that is upon the fire, on the fire, upon the altar." And verse 9 says, "But he shall wash the entrails and the legs with water, and the priest shall burn all on the altar as the burnt sacrificing, an offering made by fire, a sweet aroma to who? The Lord." Now, keep this in mind. When it was done and it was placed, it ascended up into, or the idea, the representation here, is that that sacrifice was placed by who? By the priest. Or in other words, there in Exodus, it says, hey, when any of you ever make an altar, remember, place it on the ground, no cut stones, right? Don't make any steps. And that sacrifice was this idea of accepting what the sacrifice was going to do for me. And that, in that instance, was going to do. It was future tense, right? Of the promise that the Lamb of God, which is Jesus, would take away the what? The sin of the world. Because at the end of the day, again, I can have all of that, and Arlie, you correct me if I'm wrong, okay? I can do everything, right? The you shall not have other gods, no taking the name of the Lord in vain, no carven images, keeping the Sabbath, and does that still make me a good Christian? Absolutely not. What saves me as a Christian? The only thing is Jesus, right? And the reflection of that is that therefore, I follow the stipulations and the rules, not out of fear, but out of what? Out of love for what the sacrifice has done for who? For me. Does that make sense? Are we now looking at this idea of the Ten Commandments in a little broader sense, in a little more light on it, that it's not about me keeping it, it's about what Jesus has done for me, and therefore, what that sacrifice is doing for me, I say, I want it. Does that make sense? But at the end of the day, I can't do it perfectly. Rick, are you a perfect husband? He goes like this, right? I don't know, right? Am I a perfect husband? Ask my wife. She might say yes, right? But at the end of the day, what Jesus is pointing us to is this idea that when we put Jesus in a proper context, it's like a sweet-smelling aroma. Our worship, our memorial, our altars are all pointing to what makes it sweet, like barbecue, right? Because that's what it was. The nice smell of barbecue for God was not that it was a dead lamb being burned. It was that it was the representation of Jesus, right, being placed on that altar. And when God smelled that, he said, that's my guy. That's my girl, right? That's my son. That's my daughter. Right? Now, let's go to Leviticus chapter 3 just to sort of clamp in on this idea of the sweet-smelling aroma. Look at what it says in Leviticus chapter 3, verses 14 to 16. Then he shall offer it from his offering as an offering made by fire to the Lord. The fat covers the entrails and all the fat that entrails, the two kidneys and the fat on them and the flanks. So he's putting them the whole thing here, right? And look at what it says in verse 16. And the priest shall burn them on the altar as food, an offering made by fire for a sweet what? A sweet aroma to who? to the Lord. So here it is again, this idea. Now keep this in mind, okay? The idea here of what God is doing in Exodus chapter 20. Now check this out, right? You could say, let's make the altar out of gold. Let's give God the best, right? And let's decorate it nicely. Right? So God, but God's instruction was, look, make it out of dirt or stone. And if you place your tool on this altar, I don't want it. You know why? Because there is nothing my Sabbath keeping doesn't recommend me to God. It is a full surrender to him and accepting what the sacrifice has done for who? For me. That is what recommends me to God. Accepting what Jesus has done. You know how I know this? Let's go to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. And we're going to see here. Actually, I think I have it up here on the screen. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. It says, therefore, be imitators of God as dear children. Walk in love as Christ also has loved us. And what? Given himself for us. Now, this is the place. He has given himself for us. How? Right? That's the question. How? As an offering, a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling what? Aroma. Where is Paul getting this idea of the sweet-smelling aroma from? He is getting it from Scripture, right? And in particular, he's at least some of the texts that we just read, right? As a sweet-smelling aroma. Turn to the person next to you and tell them, hey, you smell great today. Some of you didn't turn at all. Oh, that's all right. Right? Right? As a sweet-smelling aroma, what is Paul saying here? Right? And saying, hey, be imitators of God as dear children, as God loved himself, as God loved the church, and he gave himself for her as an offering, a sweet, what? A sweet-smelling aroma for God. Right? In other words, right, the idea here in putting this altar. Now, I submit to you that there are many altars in our daily walk. There's the altar of our family. There's the altar of work. Some of us might even have the altar of money. Maybe some of us have the altar of talents. Maybe some of us have an altar of good looks, right? Maybe some of us have an altar of whatever. You fill in the blank. And what God is putting to us here and painting this picture of the altar is if we make it out of dirt and stone, right, it is this idea that we do not need to decorate the altars in our lives. It needs to have Jesus in that altar. Because it is him who died for you. It is him who provides for you. It is him that deserves the memorial and the praise, because at the end of it all, what are we made of? In creation, what was man made out of? Dirt. Right? And he says, look, if you put a stone on it and you touch it with a tool, I don't want it because it has you in it. And what I'm looking at is not completely what you can do for it, but just accepting it. Right? For God so loved the world that he what? He gave his son, that whosoever believes in this shall not what? Perish, but have everlasting life. In other words, in this altar, what we do, and when we see Jesus on the altar, we don't do anything for it. Our talent doesn't work. Our decoration doesn't work. Our lightings are, all of these are just excuses to let people know how awesome God is, but that doesn't recommend us to God. What the altar represents is there, is what Jesus wants you to accept. It's just that very thing. Believe. I should have gotten an amen. Right? It's believe in what Jesus is doing, what Jesus has done, and what he will do in your life, personally for me. I can't decorate it. I can dress nice, but that's not going to recommend me to God. I can have a nice suit, but that's not going to recommend me to God. What is going to recommend me to God? Accepting the sacrifice of that altar, and keep this in mind, why not any steps? I want you to think of for a second all the pagan artifacts that we have, and think of Machu Picchu for a second, right? And how you had to climb up, because the thought was in pagan times that as you go higher, right, you would get closer to God. But he says there that when you make this altar, make it on the earth, or make it of earth, on the earth, of stone, and don't touch it. Why? Because the sacrifice, Jesus, you don't need to do anything to come up. And now there are even some religions, some that say they're Christian religions, that you need to go a certain amount of steps up to an altar, to a place to reach God. And God says, that's not how I work. I come down to you. Jesus has already come down to us on the foot of the cross. What we can do, because there's nothing that we can do that can recommend it. There's nothing that we can do for our own saving. It's only trusting on what Jesus has done on that altar. The moment I touch it, the moment I put my wisdom, the moment I put my hands, the moment I put my decoration on it, God says, you have ruined it. I don't want it. Because what people are going to notice is, hey, I build a better altar than Carmen. After all, I'm a great altar maker, right? Maybe Claudia's a little bit better than me, but no one's going to beat me. I make mine out of gold, right? I make mine out of silver. And God says, no. You make it out of dirt, and you make it out of stone. Because at the end of the day, it's not the altar. It's what's on the altar is that sweet-smelling aroma, which is accepting Jesus Christ today. Now, that makes the Ten Commandments a lot more beautiful than just simply following a set of rules, right? My Sabbath keeping is therefore important in the sense that it doesn't win me to heaven, but it says, hey, I want to be with my Lord. And then when Friday night comes, right, I'm entering into that intimate time with him. Does that make sense? And saying, hey, he died for me. He has done it all. He gave his son. He gave himself. The least I can do is actually take it seriously. The least I can do is not take the Lord's name in vain. The least I can do, I will have no other gods before me. The least I can do is I will not bow down to anything else. Nothing else will take priority other than what Jesus has done for me. And that's why I say it's important for us to recognize there's one simple concept I use when reading scripture. When you think you know something, keep reading. That's it. If you find a favorite text, if you find anything in the scripture, a theology or whatever, a doctrine in it, right? And you say, oh, this is awesome, this is great, it's my favorite text, right? We all have our favorite text. My challenge to you is keep reading. Keep going on that text and see what it says, because oftentimes we see these great texts, right? We see these great texts in scripture, but we know, in other words, we're Adventists and we know the commandments and we preach on them and we believe them, but what we need to do is keep reading. And we're going to see that when we keep reading, we'll find Jesus. If your doctrine does not have Jesus, I'm sorry, that's not a true doctrine. We can study together if you want the challenge, right? That's what we're doing Wednesday nights, right? Because at the end of the day, we want to know, we want to recognize that we want to worship God, and we want a memorial of what God has done through us. Coming here to church is not a crutch, right? Where I had a bad week. I wasn't doing very well this week. I may have done a little bad things during the week, but, you know, coming to church makes me feel a little bit better. That's not what church does. Church and the purpose of church and the worship experience that we have in church is what God has done all week long for us. And when I come here, I don't come with the idea of, get me, pastor. I come here and say, oh, praise the Lord, what he has done all week long. That's true worship. Worship is not what they can give me, but what I give to God, and that's my heart. It's everything. It's believing in that sacrifice, in that altar, that when I cut the stone and I put my own workings in it, God says, I'm sorry, but that's not how I work. Because at the end of the day, he is God, and he will provide. He will do. He will save. Does that make sense? He's the one that's going to do it. I have two quotes for you, and we're done. It says the following. Could you, my app closed. Could you go to the next one, please? It says, I believe in a physician. Now, this is a poem. And look at what this poem says. I believe in a physician. I put my case into the physician's hands. I trust him to cure me. I believe in a lawyer when I leave my case in his hands. I trust him to plead for me. I believe in the banker when I put my money into his hands and allow him to keep it on my behalf. It continues saying, I believe. I what? Believe. I believe in my Savior when I take him to be my Savior. When I put my helpless case into his hands, I trust him to do what I cannot do for what? Myself. One more quote. It says, that was it? I thought I had one more quote. All right. Cool. Right? And so what we, it was the Spirit. And so what the Lord is telling you and I this morning is all you need to do is accept Jesus Christ. There are many of us who've been in church for years and have not accepted Jesus. There are many of us who have been in this walk and have not truly known and have thought that the commandment keeping was the ideal. That's what I'm trying to reach. God says, no. Right? What you have to do is accept the sacrifice. Accept what's on the altar. Don't put your tools on it. Don't put your wisdom on it. Don't put your talent on it. Don't put your craftiness on it. Don't put anything else that belongs to you on it, because he gave it to you anyways. He doesn't need it. He just needs your heart. He needs you to believe in him and what he has done in your life. And the Ten Commandments is a good idea. I love them. You know why? Because it lets me know, you know, what it's like marry my wife and then she tells me nothing, what she likes, what she hates, what she does. It was, you know, that'd be kind of hard and frustrating, right, gentlemen? Right? And so this idea, God is disclosing his heart, his character, the transcript of his heart, and letting you know that the best thing you can do is accept Jesus. This world will tell you, no. Live your life first. You know what I used to think? I'm in my late 30s, I think. And I used to believe and say, hey, I need to have fun before I truly become a Christian. That's what I used to believe. But then I realized that the more I dived into the world, the more empty I felt. And I had many altars in my life, many altars, but none of them had Jesus. And they all felt incomplete. And you know what happens into that? You always feel like you're not in the world. The world offers this luxury and this awesomeness and this do what you want to do and do it the way you want to do. And you could be whatever you want to be. And okay, but at the end of the day, you feel just as empty as you did yesterday. And trust me, I've been there. But at the end of the day, the only place where I truly felt that I had a sense of purpose was in the presence of God. And those moments where he called in my heart and said, hey, you know what? That will only last a little while. That, at the end of the day, is going to lead you nowhere. It's a dead end. It's a dead end with nice houses. That's all it is, right? What it is, what it should be, is Jesus Christ is the author and finisher, what does the Bible say, of our faith. Paul says in Hebrew, and I'm just rambling on, but I'm about to finish. Paul says in Hebrew, says, hey, look, the blood of bulls and goats. Why do we keep, he's asking the Jews, he's saying, why do we keep killing? If it was working, then we should stop. And Paul says, why do we keep coming bull after year and bulls and bulls and killing goats and killing rams every single year? If it's working, then we should stop, right? That's a logical question. And he says, the only thing, the only true sacrifice is Jesus Christ. And when we trust in him, don't worry about how other people do it. Don't worry about how the pastor does it. Don't worry about how your parents do it. Don't worry about how the elders do it. It's just you and Jesus. And tell Jesus, Jesus, teach me. One of the things I've learned in my walk, in my Christian walk, is that if you challenge God, he's more than willing to take up your challenge. Never, not once, when I have challenged God and said, all right, God, show me, has he left me down? And I want to challenge you today to challenge God and say, all right, God, what is it? What do you want? What's my altar? What's that altar that you want me to get rid of? Where I can place Jesus instead of the other stuff that I have. Challenge him. But be ready. Be ready. It's like praying for patience. I used to have a church, the Auburn Church in New York. When a sister used to talk and say, hey, you know what? You should pray for patience. They said, no, I'm not praying for patience, right? Because they know that if you pay for patience, God is going to give you some patience, right? I remember brother, like, make you a principal of a school, right? Right? You know, dealing with kids, I've been there. I'm a teacher. I know how to, what it's like working with kids. It is, whoo, have mercy. Yeah, you learn the patience of the saints in school, right? It's understanding that when we look at that, when we look at that altar, not an alterated altar, not an altar that I have cut, but just an altar. And it's made out of dirt, out of stone, and it's dirty, just like my life, just like me. But what needs to be placed on it is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the one true Savior of the world. And I dare you to find another one. I dare you. Find something else. You won't find it. Only Jesus Christ. As the praise team comes up, I want us to think about the altars in our life. What are those altars? The altar of marriage, relationships, the altars of scars that life has given you, the altar of anger, the altar of, oh, church is boring, right? The altar of, man, this guy takes too long, right? The altar of talent, the altar of money, of cars, maybe even the altar of sex, I don't know. Right, you know what that altar is. But God is inviting you and say, hey, get rid of that. I don't need it. I just need you to accept me. Is there someone here this morning who wants to accept Jesus Christ along with me and say, hey, I wanna recommit. Lord, yeah, you know, sometimes those other altars tend to sneak in and say, hey, Lord, just get rid of those altars and make me focus on that true altar, which is Jesus Christ. I want to invite you and stand. I want to pray for you. But I will pray after we sing. And as we sing, I want to pray that you accept the altar of Jesus Christ. Dear Father God, we thank you, Father, for that altar that you have described to us that we should build in our hearts to know that Christ is enough for me. Father, we thank you. We pray, Father, that as we leave this place, your Spirit be with us and remind us that we are not rejected, we are not forsaken, for your promise is that you will always be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tell the person next to you, Jesus is enough for me.